everybody. Maybe would like to some Europeans in Turkey. The topic of the talk is evaluation infrastructure for IR experimentation. In this talk, we will basically discuss ongoing work in a European project which is called PROMISE, that among other things is trying to build an software infrastructure to support evaluation campaigns or different kinds of evaluation activities, as well as to manage, preserve and provide access to the experimental data produced during the evaluation cycles. So basically the outline of the talk is an introduction to motivation for an evaluation infrastructure, why we need an evaluation infrastructure, then a discussion on modeling aspects for the evaluation infrastructure. So here we will talk about the concept, the entities, and the relationships among the entities we need to take into account to develop such kind of system. And I will give a brief outline on the architecture of this infrastructure to make you understand how it works and to make it clear how several different possible outcomes can be derived from this architecture, and then post some conclusions and possibilities for extension and collaboration. So, why an evaluation infrastructure? Basically, one question we should ask ourselves as organizers of evaluation fora and as participants in evaluation fora is how much available are our data. There is a well-known study made by Trek in 2010 about its economic impact, and the NIST estimated in about $30 million the overall investment in track for its first nearly 20 years. So it's more than $1 million per year invested in track. And probably this amount of money would grow if we count also the investment, the effort, human resources put by participants into taking part into evaluation activities. So if you consider that an evaluation campaign basically produces experimental data, scientific data, which are the experimental collections, the runs, the performance measures, all the statistical analysis, plot, and whatever we usually do during an evaluation cycle, these data have an economic, not negligible economic value to the producer. On the other hand, the overall goal of evaluation is to improve systems, to give feedback as far as is concerned if they provide the required effectiveness with respect to user needs, and so on and so forth. And one important part of this work is to conduct failure analysis. I have seen talks yesterday, they tried to figure out why some techniques went well and why some techniques went bad. And this is extremely important because the goal of the game is not to get out numbers that are nicer or not. The goal is to understand how our system works, what we need to do to improve them, or if we are already in the right direction. Unfortunately, failure analysis is quite a labor-intensive activity because basically you have to inspect your result list, to inspect have misbehaved, or if you have some other intermediate step, as in the yesterday call that was clustering, how the clustering algorithm may affect the overall performance in the storm and so forth. In 2004, there has been an important workshop organized by Don Arnold and Chris Buckley, the Reliable Information Access Workshop, where they were focusing on relevance feedback. And basically, they made, I don't remember, 10, 20 people to sit in the same room for several weeks. They analyzed their system, so they submitted a run for a topic, and they all together analyzed the outcome of the topic, the documents, what happened with relevant feedback, what went well, what went wrong, and they estimated that it took from 11 to 40 hours per topic to carry out a detailed failure analysis, which is really a huge amount of work to understand what is good and what is bad in your system. And this is just, in a sense, an intermediate step, because once you have understood the reason of a failure, you have to fix your system to re-implement the code and run another evaluation round to see if your modifications have the desired effect or not. So, using and interpreting our experimental data is an extremely resource-intensive activity. But these data are the pillars for all the subsequent scientific and technological development, because both industry and academia relies on our evaluation activities to drive the development of multilingual information access systems. And this is actually an activity that is worth to perform. Indeed, always in that economic impact study, TREC estimated that the return on investment produced by TREC activities has been around $3 to $5 for each dollar invested by NIF for both academia and industry, which basically means that if NIF put $30 million of investment, they produced from $90 to $150 million of return of investment, which is an impressive amount of money. All of this makes us understand that our experimental data are extremely important, that we need to guarantee their accessibility and interpretability over the time. And this is not always the case, in the sense that the current common practice in all the evaluation campaigns is that there is some web server or FTP server where there are some directories with text files in them, and after asking to campaign organizers and signing some copyright agreements or whatever, you get a password to browse in this directory structure. But this is not exactly making data easily accessible, neither making them interpretable over the time, because there are many different formats for the rounds, different formats for the topics, different ways in which you interpret the relevance judgments. So then it's difficult without a lot of contextual information to easily reuse those data. And since these data are also an important part of our scientific and technological work, is really important to rate them, so to spot errors, for example, to say, oh, this topic is not a good topic because it has too many relevant documents, so it's too easy, or too few relevant documents, so went wrong, or it works for Hindi, but it doesn't retrieve documents on the Bengali collection. Many things can happen, and these are usually known to organizers or are written somewhere in overview papers and so on and so forth. But if you are a newcomer or an outsider and you want to take an experimental collection and know what is useful to use, it's much more difficult to retrieve all this information. And it's also much more difficult in this case for you to get the same numbers that the organizers get, because maybe that they decided to skip that topic in computing averages or whatever, and you don't know that, and you wonder why. If I do the same experiment on the same set of data, they get some figures and I get different figures. And you need a lot of time to figure out the reason, which typically is a simple practical reason, and to carry on your work. So we really need to curate the data, facilitate their use, and also enrich the data with user annotation or explanation about what is good, what is wrong with data. Another point is that actually we must say that the IR field has almost no tradition in managing its own data. Because the idea that a text file of whatever format is managing data is not really the truth. I mean, if you go to a database person and you tell him, okay, a bunch of text files, it's in a directory structure, it's a database, and if you want to manage your data, you can always add some Perl or whatever other language script to process them in a fancy way, maybe this person has some doubts about these. In the example, you also see how different a topic can look like. So it's always a topic. The first one, it's a typical ad hoc topic, which is also from let's say format point of view, almost XML, almost SGML, so it's not really possible in an automatic way. Then really XML topics, but there is no schema associated to this topic, so it's difficult to know what is the structure of the topic, how do you interpret all the fields, apart from an automatic information processing point of view. If you are not a human that has read some guidelines that are not always accessible over and over the time, and you ask something. This is also worsened in the case, for example, of QRS, relevance judgments, because QRS are driven basically by Retrieval, which is our standard de facto program for computing performances, and basically everybody tries to fit in their information in the fields that the Retrieval format program expects. The fields are not really documented. You know by oral tradition what is the meaning of each field and what you should use or not. And basically from task to task and task to evaluation to evaluation, these fields are often overloaded and have different meanings. So for example, the first one is a typical ad hoc QRL, where the second column was the Q0, the iteration in the relevance feedback, that by default is always zero in ad hoc. But in diversity, they overloaded it to represent which facet of a topic you are considering. Then you have also relevance grades, which can be different because you can have 0, 1, 2, 3, 0, 1, minus 1, 2, whatever format you may invent. This is a problem for automatic management, obviously. encounters, because basically the same text format may mean many different things in a different context. So what we need, and that's part of the follow-up in the talk, is a common data model that allow us to represent the information, the entities, and the relationship between the entities that are involved in the information space or an evaluation activity, a data model which is powerful enough to support for extension to specific cases. And we also need to have the capability of adding metadata, descriptive metadata, administrative metadata, copyright metadata, whatever kind of metadata we need in order to collate and enrich the entities we are managing in our evaluation. Another point is that there is no easy link between scientific production and experimental data, in the sense that in our draft papers or in our overview papers, we refer to our experimental data, but we do that in many different ways. So, for example, we refer to the name of the participant, the institution that participated to talk about their experiment, or we use the name of the system they have built as an alias for the same thing, or we use the identifier of a specific experiment if we are going to provide a granularity. But basically, what we miss is something like the references in a paper. We cannot, we don't have a way to refer to an experiment, to a topic, to a statistical test or whatever we are using in our discussion, to link it as we do with references to other papers, journals, conferences, and so on. And often is somehow difficult to know exactly what data have been used. So it's quite common to say, okay, for this, I have developed a new evaluation measure, and I want to see the correlation with other measures. And to show this, I use track 7 data. Adopt data, yes, but exactly what? Okay, I selected the subset of topic used by Clever Dalberg in his paper about DCG. Ah, okay. And what about the runs? Not all the runs, but only the runs above the mean in the result set. A lot of details that often make it difficult to reproduce or reuse all the experimental data. So what we may need is the possibility of citing, directly citing our experimental data in the paper, and to make our papers in a sense actionable or executable. By executable, I mean providing in the paper direct links or direct connection with online versions of the data or of the system that have produced the data, and so on and so forth. So, what we may want for evaluation infrastructure, as well. So we may want that it helps to lower the effort and the cost for running evaluation activities. In a sense that it actually reducing the fragmentation in the experimental evaluation landscape in terms of different formats, slight variation of similar concepts, heterogeneity in the collections, metadata, name of the measures you use, and so on, provides different ways of managing, curating, access the data over the time, and enhances the ways for interacting, visualizing, and exploring the experimental data. That, for example, once we have an evaluation infrastructure, we may ask it to support continuous evaluation of information access and retrieval system. That means plugging the evaluation infrastructure, like a kind of test to a system, and automatically run a set of standard tests. Or the other way around, that this evaluation infrastructure exposes APIs proper programmatic access to it and allow you to build your own application on top of it according to your needs. So, how proceed in this sense? First of all, you need a careful and also shared and discussed modeling activity. Then, obviously, you need to design and develop a software system and other key activities are sharing this system or this infrastructure to facilitate its adoption, but also its extension and its improvement in order to be sure that it is able to support the needs of a broader community. So, for modeling. Now, I will show you some of the part of the model developed for the evaluation infrastructure in promise. What you see here is an entity relationship diagram, which is commonly used in databases for modeling the information space of interest. The point here is not to get into the details of these diagrams, but to use it as a kind of vocabulary to make you understand what are the supported concepts in our evaluation infrastructure. In these diagrams, the rectangles are entities, so something that has its own autonomous life, it's a resource in a loose web sense, and diamonds are relations among those entities. So, first of all, what is the core of an evaluation infrastructure is an evaluation activity. And in our case, we identified three kinds of evaluation activities. Evaluation campaigns, as we all know, but also we called them trials, let's say evaluation activities that are not public evaluation campaigns. Imagine a company or a research group that is carrying out its own evaluation activities for their partners, that we called these trials. And all of these activities, all of these entities may have different scopes or different access permissions. What I mean that you can have something that is public for everybody, but you can have a trial which is private only to your company or to your research group, or a trial which is shared among different research groups that can see it but is not public accessible. So different levels of accessibility. And another kind of evaluation activity we have imagined is for education, so for IAP courses where you may want your students to train with a real IAP system, one of those that comes out of the box, you see in the VA, or whatever, and you want your students to experiment with a small evaluation of their outcomes. And also, then we have tracks, tasks, and the user stuff. Then, multiple media that can be comprised of many topics, subtopics, so can be very articulated as the example you have seen. We have the notion of corpus with the information units, so the documents of the experimental collection, and the notion of ground truth, so the relevance assessment. Actually, this is extensible, so it can be relevance assessment in the traditional IR way, but can be gold standard in a more LLC-oriented way or question answering oriented way. So this is a kind of entity that can be